Hi, everybody, and welcome to Paul Lisnick Behind the Curtain, my opportunity to leave the world of politics and law that you watch me cover on television to talk about the fantastic world of entertainment. And what a treat today. Not often do you get to talk to a legend in the music, theater, arts world, but today I get a chance to do just that with somebody who, I'll be honest, I have admired, I hate to say it, but since I was a young kid. And I don't know what it is about Paul Williams that has intrigued me, but for years, Paul Williams, I have loved your stuff. And thank you so much for being. We're going to talk about a show you're just doing now, but thank you for joining me.
Oh, thank you, Paul. It means a lot. That's what I call a heart payment to hear that. Thank
you. It's true, because you know you probably have people that interview you and you know they kind of look you up or whatever. No, I go back and for folks who are joining us, maybe who just aren't as familiar with some of your previous work. I mean, this is the guy who wrote an old-fashioned love song, "Rainy Days and Mondays," the Carpenters music. I mean, let's just put it in a category. "Won't Last a Day Without You." And I have to tell you, when I was in high school, my English teacher married a math teacher, and the two of them got married to "We've Only Just Begun."
How cool is that?
And yeah. And he forced us to study that song for an entire semester as we pulled apart every lyric, every whatever, to study the brilliance of that song. Anything you care to say to Larry Carlino if he's alive and watching?
I'd like to apologize to every student who had to put up with that. You know, I'm glad he enjoyed the song and everything, and what an amazing compliment. Yeah, you know, it had all the romantic beginnings of a bank commercial. I was writing songs with Roger Nichols. We were having amazing success in the sense that all of our songs were being recorded. None of them were making it to the airways. We were writing album cuts and B-sides. Nobody knew who we were until the Carpenters showed up at A&M Records, and they knew a lot of our things from album cuts, from B-sides and the like. We were thrilled. It was like, wow, somebody knows who we are. But what happened, essentially, just a quick story about "We've Only Just Begun."
Yeah, please.
Is that there was a wonderful songwriter named Tony. There is a wonderful Tony songwriter named Tony Asher, man who wrote "God Only Knows" for Brian. Wonderful, who had a job writing a commercial for a song for a commercial for a Crocker Bank. Very different commercial. No pitch, no sales pitch, just a young couple getting married. You see the kiss, the driving off after the reception, and the one line, "You've got a long way to go. We'd like to get you, to help you get there, the Crocker Bank." And he broke his arm skiing, and he couldn't do it. So he called Roger. He said, "I've recommended you and Paul." And I was like, "I don't want to do a bank commercial. I'm street. I'm black, white light and black leather," you know, which of course is as far away as what I actually probably was. But I didn't want to write a bank commercial. And he said, "There's a creative fee in it." I said, "Let's write this bank commercial."
Right.
So we wrote it. I think we wrote it in an afternoon. We finished the first two verses that were the commercial into a complete song in case anyone wanted to record it. Paul, there was no way in the world this was ever going to be a hit, because the number one album at the time was in a Gotta Da Vida. And then an angel sang it. Richard Carpenter heard me singing it on the commercial. He said, "Is there a full song?" They recorded it. And the next thing you know, your entire class is studying the song.
Sounds like you didn't expect that would become, I mean, for many, many years, even today, that is the song many people get married to as they walk down the aisle.
Exactly. That and Evergreen seem to have had kind of kicked into that spot. I've never written a divorce song, although I've done it twice. I'm happily married now for all of 18 years. And, so I'm way past wanting to write a divorce song.
And I was, of course, going to bring up Barbra Streisand. In the middle of listening to her 48 hours of audio, she recorded her new autobiography book on tape, as, of course, Barbra was not going to let anybody else do that.
Of course. But I haven't heard it yet. Have you heard it?
I'm listening to it. I'm on chapter four.
You're
listening to it
right now. Oh my!
And
goodness.
By the way, I would recommend. I mean, read the book if you want to. But listening to her do it with her inflections, it's fabulous. Can you share a memory about working with Barbra to write Evergreen?
Oh my God, she expected you to be as good as she is. Which is almost impossible. But it was just, I mean, what an amazing opportunity. I think my thoughts about it and really recognizing the reality of working with her has changed very much through the years, because I was very kind of flippant about it at the time. I was probably totally intimidated. And in those days, I'd have a couple drinks and a little toot or something. And my confidence, you know, the confidence lifted me up to the place where I could work with somebody like Barbra Streisand. I think that that what happens over the years, we know, is that as alcoholism is a progressive disease, we find that the confidence can turn into arrogance. And my life kind of got off the tracks. But at the time that I was working with Barbra, I felt like in many ways I was at the top of my game. It was an amazing opportunity. I thought that she was, she had opinions about everything she was in. And it was, of course she does. She is about to embark on the biggest picture of her life that she's involved in the production. She's involved in every piece of it. We have 7 weeks to write a score. You know, she and John Peters actually called me about writing one song. I got a phone call. I was actually being fitted for a tuxedo. And my wife came in and she said, "It's Barbra Streisand. She wants to talk to you." And I went like, "Oh my God, it's Barbra Streisand. Hello,
tell her I'm getting a fitting."
"Hello, Barbra. This is Mr. Confidence here. I'm getting a tuxedo fit." Watch that in team, you know. And what she basically said was, there's a wonderful song that you wrote called "You and Me Against the World," which I wrote with Kenny Asher, and Helen Reddy sang. She said, "I'm doing A Star Is Born, and at the end of the picture, there's a place where I find a song that John Norman Howard has written but never recorded. And I want to end the picture with me singing that song. And You and Me Against the World kind of fits that. Would you consider writing something for this?" And that's what she said. That's not what I heard. What I heard was, "I want you to write all the songs for A Star Is Born." And so when I showed up and they sent me a script, I had like notes on this would be about that and like that. When they asked me to leave the room, they being Barbra and John Peters, and then brought me back in, and they said, John said to me, you're not intimidated by this, are you?" And I said, "Absolutely not. I'm sure, because I said earlier, I probably was." But he said, "That's not what we ask you at all, but it's interesting." And I said, "Well, I'd love to do it, and I'd love to bring Kenny Asher in. I'd love to, I'd love to have Kenny and I, because that's the song that got us the job in the first place. And I think he'd write wonderful music. He'd also be a great contributor to putting the band together for Christofferson and the like," which he was. But it was the beginnings of it, and it was literally 7 weeks to write. And we wrote, I think, seven of the songs on there. We wrote almost all the songs for Chris. We wrote "Woman on the Moon," "Watch Closely Now," "Woman on the Moon," "Everything," "With One More Look at You." I mean,
amazing song. Yeah, that was one of my. Exactly. I mean, I listened to that soundtrack a gazillion times a day. I mean, it was just amazing. And of course, your career gets the Academy Award, Golden Globes, Grammys.
We hit the hat trick, all three.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Amazing.
That's what it's like to work with Barbra Streisand. You try to rise to the occasion. And one of the great memories is of her sitting down very shyly. Incidentally, if you try to imagine Barbra shyly picking up a guitar and going, "Is this something you could use?" And going, "Bah," just learning to play the guitar, searching for the chords, "Bah, bah, da, da, dee, da, da." Looking for the chord, "Da, da, 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 dee, da, da." And she sings me that melody. And I went, "Oh my God, there's your love theme right there."
You know, and she had to work with the nails too, right? You had the nails with the guitar.
With the nails, exactly.
I'm sure to get, listen, I, of course, look, producers are going to be mad if we don't talk about the reason we're talking, which is your amazing work with Jim Henson's Emmet Otter's Jug-Band Christmas, playing at the Studebaker Theater now in Chicago. That's where you and I met just the other night and took our quick picture. We're going to talk about that. But I mean, this walk down memory lane is amazing. I just want a little more background. By the way, I just got back from a trip to Omaha. Any memories from Omaha?
None really. My dad was building Boys Town. My dad was a builder. I went to 9 schools by the time I was in the 9th grade, but he built Boys Town. He built the Veterans Hospital in Albuquerque. He built the hangars for the B-36s in Rapid. So it was always like about a year at a school and then go to the next one, go to the next one, go to the next one, until he was killed when I was 13 in a alcohol-related car wreck. So I have two brothers who have since passed, who all three of us wound up getting sober. We caught the gene from our dad. All three of us got sober. The only difference between me and my two brothers is that I quit smoking and neither of them did. And it took them out eventually. But yeah, Omaha, I left it very young. The first time that I went on tour was opening for the Fifth Dimension. And when we played Omaha, I walked on stage and said, I was born here, and I got a great ovation. One of the biggest I'd ever heard. I went, oh, that's kind of addictive.
You're the famous guy that came from Omaha. Yeah. Well, when you look back on your, when you talk about all that you've worked and the folks you've worked with, and I'm sort of curious who the music, when you were writing, for example, commercials, Barry Manilow was doing the same thing. Well, you're working with Streisand, Marvin Hamlisch was working with Streisand. Who were your influences early on in your career?
The Great American Songbook. The first movie I ever saw that I just was, I made my mom stay. I went to see what would be called in those days a chicks flick that my mom and my aunt went to see, and they took me with them. And I made a mistake, sit through it twice, and it was called With a Song in My Heart. And it was starred Susan Hayward as Jane Froman, the singer who was injured entertaining the troops and the like. And I was just, there was a full circle moment in my life. I saw that all of a sudden my interest was in, I graduated high school in 1958, which was the era when rock and roll was born. I discovered rock and roll in the mid 60s through the Beatles. That's where I learned about Chuck Berry and all this, because in high school, I was listening to Cole Porter and Rodgers and Hart. So I was listening to Sinatra. I wasn't listening to Elvis, I happily had songs recorded by both of them, but it's interesting because from the very beginning of my affection for music, I had this amazing kind of a almost like a sense memory of loving those songs, loving the song, Johnny Burke and Van Heusen, Here's That Rainy Day, Swinging on a Star, Pennies from Heaven. It's like I knew them, So, there's a lot of people would say, past life stuff there, Paulie, who knows? But I know that it's interesting because my taste in music opened up when I began to write. My favorite band was a group at the time called the Original Delaney and Bonnie and Friends that had Leon Russell in it. Just amazing, amazing kind of a country rock gospel sort of a sounding band. But what seemed to come out of me was probably closer to what I was raised on, that kind of classic songwriting style, Plus, I wound up hooking up with Roger Nichols, who was a brilliant composer and a trained composer, and he was my music school, But at this point in my life, I have a respect all kinds of music, and I'm writing right now with a group called Portugal the Man. You look at Daft Punk, which is essentially dance music, and what we did together with Random Access Memory, which won the Grammy for Album of the Year. It's amazing to be at my age. And I turned 83 in September. I feel like a tired 34, but to be at my age and feel as attracted to the kind of music being written right now and all the different ways to do all this deal.
What is it, do you think, about your music? Here's the thing. I've talked to a lot of, I've gone to young people, whatever. I toss out some of the songs you've written when I said I was going to talk to you, and they're like, oh my God, the amazing stuff. There's a lot of songwriters in your day and after your day who have come and gone. What is it about Paul Williams' songs, music, that just have stood the test of time and, as far as I'm concerned, will always stand the test of time?
Well, a lot of it's the shoe leather that walked up to Paul Williams. Look at the people I've written with through the years. I have to just go like that. Not only to the songs that I wrote with Kenny Escher and Roger Nichols and Barbra Streisand and Gustavo Santaolalla now, and just the amazing people through the years, but how they affected what I wrote alone. Because every time I sit down with somebody and write a song, I sit down with John Vesner in Nashville and we write a song. The first song together is called You're Gone. It's a number two around the country hit and all. What did I pick up in that besides a hit writing with John Vesner? What I learned was, you almost can't put it into words, but there's an approach to writing that all these individual wonderful, wonderful geniuses bring to the table that I think shows up in my work it's borrowed information, you know.
And so many of your songs have been labeled as labeled as the most important in American music. You are a part of the American Music Songbook now. I'm curious, you get involved with Jim Henson, Rainbow Connection. I don't think I've said that title yet since we've been talking, but the world knows Rainbow Connection, one of the classics of all time. Did projects bring you in, like, let's call Paul Williams, we need him to do this, because you've got the kid stuff and then you've got the adult stuff. Did projects find you, or was there a certain genre you said, I want to write for that, and then the Rainbow Connection connects?
I just answered the phone. You know, they asked Semicon, they said, what comes first, the words or the music? He said, the phone call. It's a very famous line, you know, and he's right. For me, my whole thing with the, you know, the path that I follow, I couldn't have planned. And when I got sober, incidentally, I'm 33 years sober. That was a huge change in my life. Probably the most important thing that ever happened to me is that I finally was given, you know, relief from that, the disease of alcoholism. And when I look at the route that my life has taken, and I realize, A, you couldn't have planned it, and B, that there is a surrender to the moment, to the now, and what the now is producing, that is, if you can face it with enthusiasm and not go, oh, Jesus, I didn't get what I want. If you can go, wait a minute, Noah's a gift, there's something better coming, again and again and again. I've repeated that in my life. I've always had a very Jiminy Cricket kind of attitude about life, Paul, and I think that it's been a part of the construction process is for me to maintain that attitude.
There's also something about you. You aren't just a composer and a musician, but I mean, I watched you on Match Game. You're in The Love Boat. You were in The Odd Couple, singing to Tony Randall's daughter. You're an actor as well. What took you to the world of, you know, I'm a composer, but then we're watching, you were everywhere.
No, it was a gift. No, and the career that all I ever said I could do is act. I wanted desperately to be act. A good therapist would say and said to me, you wanted to be somebody else. You know, it's like, I used to joke that I felt like Montgomery Clift, but I looked like Haley Mills. It was hard for me to get a job as an actor. But I think I've approached songwriting as you know, especially when I look at anything with a story and characters. I mean, I'll take it right down to Ishtar. I mean, I wrote the intentionally awkward and believably bad song Ishtar, really writing for the two characters, Chuck and Lyle, the two mismatched songwriters. How would they approach this? What is it, you know? So I think that my acting has, and my desire to, you know, to examine the interior life of the character somehow manages to translate into the way that I write songs.
Glad you said that, because I had Ishtar on my list. I went, I don't know if I should bring Ishtar up with him. I don't know what his feeling is about.
Oh, I love it. I just did a thing at the Brookshire Museum where they did a bunch of clips of collections. And I think some of the best work I've ever done in my life is the believable bad songs for Ishtar. I cherish that project. And, you know, what happened is that basically the shooting schedule was reviewed instead of the film. These days, the New York Times re-reviewed the film and they gave it a glowing review, a beautiful review. But the fact is that I think that, you know, back to that thought is that I think I approach writing songs from a point of like an actor that's looking, okay, what is the interior life of what's going on with this character? What happened with Jim Henson? Because that's where you were starting to ask about, was I went over to do the Muppet Show, and I was a big fan. The great thing, Paul, about what you and I do for a living is we don't have to give up our fan cards. I mean, that's it's right. Like, I'm nuts.
I'm fanboy right now.
In the room and recognize somebody and I just gurn out. I go, oh my God, it's Quincy Jones. I've known Quincy for 50 years. I still go crazy when I see Quincy Jones, and probably always will. I think that what happened is I showed up and I'd never been a member of a gang that had a treehouse when I was a kid. When I walked onto the set of the Muppet Show in England, I felt like I had just stepped into the treehouse. I mean, there's Dave Goltz and Frank Oz and all these guys, and they have this edgy, wonderful humor and hearts that is just, you know. And Jim Henson was, the phrase that belongs completely to him, and I use it a lot, is the elegance of kindness. There was an energy to the man that was just remarkable. And, you know, he had a great relationship with a wonderful songwriter, Joe Raposa. And I was totally shocked when he handed me the book and the script for Emmet Otter's Jug-Band Christmas. And he said, would you take a look at this and see if you'd like to write the songs? And I went, oh, my God. And they poured out of me. I found that everything I've ever done with either Jim or Brian or with anything associated with the Henson, I won't even say, I have to talk about the Henson heart, if anything, that there is an energy to everything that the Muppets have done and everything that came out of the Henson family that would just have that elegance of kindness.
The thing about this show, Emmet Otter's Jug-Band Christmas, I mean, I was surprised. I did most of my homework afterwards. I just wanted to sit and enjoy the show. I knew it was a family show, so I thought, how much do I need to do ahead of time? But the Broadway quality stars, people involved in this show, this is like A-lister stuff, putting this show together.
Yeah, it is A-list. And you know what? We opened on Broadway. We developed it at the good speed, you know, probably 6 years or maybe more ago. I forget when we started. And Tim McDonald, who produced it and also has co-written the book, talked to Chris Catelli. And he said to Chris Catelli, what would you like to do? I want to do something with you. What would you like to do that you haven't had a chance to do? The first thing he mentioned was Emmet Otter's Jug-Band Christmas. And, it's interesting because people this little show, every year more people seem to watch it and it becomes part of their family tradition. Same thing with Muppet Christmas Carol, which incidentally was the first sober song score I ever wrote. And we're finding the same kind of a thing. And people are making it a part of their Christmas year after year after year.
One of the treats that happens here, and this, I'm glad I didn't do this homework and I got permission to say the fact I'm going to say, because I didn't want to ruin anything. But first of all, there's little Easter eggs to you all over the place, right? They're the building is the Williams Opera House. There's you all over it. But as I'm sitting and I'm listening to Pa Otter sing this beautiful song called Alice Keep Dreaming, I was sitting there going, I swear that's Paul Williams' voice. But I know you're sitting behind me in the audience, so it ain't you up there. And I asked, and I found out later, and I asked, they said, no, it's okay. It's, you don't have to keep it a secret. That, what a great tribute to you. That is your voice in the show.
Well, yeah, Tim asked me to do that. And I wrote a bunch of new songs for the show. Just the history of something that had that pure, the touch of, it deserves to be called Jim Henson's Emmet Otter's Jug-Band Christmas, because it is absolutely Jim's jam.
And that is the full name. And you're right.
It's right up on the top of the theater at the opening of the proscenium. But the show, you know, it's interesting because we opened on Broadway. We did open on New York at the New View. And the New Vic, sorry, and got amazing reviews. I mean, the New York Times was you couldn't do better for reviews. It was amazing. I never saw this show because I was sitting in my hotel room with COVID the entire run. It only ran a very brief time because everybody started closing because of COVID. We were all shut down. So it's essentially now it's sprung to life again at the Studebaker. And what a wonderful, wonderful theater it is. I mean, Chicago has a gem there and it's got great history, but it's also as up to date and as wonderful a place to see and hear a musical. I hope you enjoyed it.
Well, I did. And what I loved about it, the Studebaker is, I'm sure you know, newly renovated. The guy running the place now was there on opening night. And one of the things that's fabulous is, look, you know, we've got the big Broadway houses within the city and there's plenty of that. But this is sort of almost a new venue now that it's renovated. It's intimate. It's large enough to have lots of people, but there's still an intimate feeling about it with some boxes where you can bring your family and watch.
Even though it's a much larger theater than it feels like. It feels like just a jewel box.
Yeah, just totally amazing. Do you get more? I know that it's when the phone rings, but what projects give you? Is it writing for a film? Is it writing a Broadway show? Where does Paul Williams become most alive?
Well, I love walking on a set as an actor. I just spent 2 years with Billy Bob Thornton on Goliath. You know, I don't know if you ever saw Goliath or not on Amazon Prime, but it was like I was on the second and third season. And just to work with somebody like Billy, I mean, it's just, I mean, I'm just absolutely, I mean, the first movie I did was a movie called The Loved One with Jonathan Winters and Sir John Gielgud and this amazing cast and all. And
there's two names you'd put together.
Little kid from the Midwest walking around with, looking at that Panavision camera and all those lights, and Haskell Wexler is shooting it and lighting it. And it's like, oh my God, how did I get here? And there's a part of me that when I walk on a set feels that and all the projects, I mean, especially the film projects, you know, the Muppet Christmas Carol, the Muppet movie, and the stuff with the Hensons is really special. But just look at the directors I've been able to work with. Brian De Palma on Phantom of the Paradise, you know, I was in The Doors, you know, I mean, it's just been great fun. And every now and then I get a decent acting job, but I'm a songwriter and an advocate for songwriters. I love my life and these days, you know, these days that also includes my work at ASCAP, which I'm really, really proud of.
Absolutely. You are president and chairman there of ASCAP. And I think that's so great at 83 to be doing that kind of stuff. That's just phenomenal. And by the way, I want to, David Foster, I'm sure you know David, is now working on his first Broadway musical, Boop. He's here in Chicago. He's here while you were.
Oh, he was.
Working at so that opens. It's actually in previews now, but it's pre-Broadway. Jerry Mitchell put it together. It's called Boop, the Betty Boop musical, but it's Foster's first endeavor into Broadway. And I'm sort of curious, what advice or thoughts do you have? Was stepping into writing a Broadway show, like in your case, Jim Henson's Emmet Otter, is it sort of I can do it, it's one more project, or is Broadway a different world?
Well, I think theater is a different world, but it's wonderful because the first big discovery about theater is that the audience becomes your collaborator. You know, as you begin to, you know, I mean, I wrote a musical based on Happy Days with Gary Marshall, and I wrote some, you know, some songs that I knew. I mean, it's like, oh my God, this is the Tony winning song, Gary. This is this moment between Fonzie, you know, and Mrs. the, you know, it was oh my God, what. And the audience,
this is Cunningham.
It's like it doesn't work. And I never would have guessed that. And you have to be willing to, what's the old saying? Have to be willing to kill your babies. You have to go, you know what?
So it's the classic trunk of songs. There's some songs still in the trunk that just didn't work for you.
The one they get in the trunk, you know, they suffocate and they go away. Evidently. You know, I've never pulled a song out of a trunk for anything at all. But what I think, it's interesting because I don't think this will ever be a problem with David. David is very, very sharp. One of the things that happens with songwriters when they go to the stage, they want to write a hit song. You know, we all want to have a hit song, but the songs really need to do two things. They need to move the characters, you know, they need to give us a look into the character's inner life, and they need to move the story forward. They need to be key to the story. They need to expose pieces of what's going on that in a way that suggests emotionally beyond just the action of what is occurring. And how does it feel to that person at that moment? And it's just an amazing, so the script becomes everything. And for my whole life, from the beginning as an actor to writing the songs for Bugsy Malone or Phantom of the Paradise or an end title for a Clint Eastwood movie with, you know, where Jeff Bridges is dying and to write a song that fits that moment. It comes from the script, it comes from the story, it comes from the inner life of the character. David's going to figure that out on his own very quickly.
Well, he will. And December 6th is opening, so come back to Chicago, be my guest for opening night.
When does it open?
Well, it'll be playing. It'll still be here. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
well, yeah. It's just the 6th is open.
Knowing David, I would think it's going to be there a long time, and probably, and I wish him the best.
Well, it's heading to Broadway. So, first of all, and I thank you, and I hope you work on stuff until you're past 100, because the thought of...
Thank you. Thank
we got to have your stuff.
Well, you know, I'm working on Pan's Labyrinth with Guillermo del Toro right now for the stage, which is wonderful. I'm writing with a group called Portugal the Man. I've got another musical called Fortunate Sons, which is... In the midst of some major rewriting right now, where instead of talk about everything, we're going to show a little action for a change. I love my life. And Paul, thank you.
I'm loving it.
I appreciate it.
People get tickets at EmmettOtterLive.com. Jim Henson's Emmett Otter's Jug-Band Christmas, playing at the Studebaker till December 31st. We've got less than a minute left, but can you sing us out with your favorite song?
My favorite song is from if I'm going to sing something from Emmet Otter, it would have to be, well, when the mountain touches the valley, all the clouds are taught to fly. Thus our souls shall leave this land most peacefully. Yes, though our minds be filled with questions, and our hearts will understand when the river meets the almighty sea.
Paul, I thank you. We're going to get cut off. It didn't cut you off. How dare it cut you off while you're singing? You're fantastic. I love you. I have admired you forever. I can't wait for your next project. Paul Williams, thank you. You're a gift to the planet.
You are as well, Paul. Thanks for your advocacy. God bless and kindness.
And to you.